Hi there and welcome to PhD at Living. Today is episode 4 of our discussion on nuclear weapons, and we just got done talking about the colossal misery of uranium enrichment. Remember that because U-235 and U-238 are the same element, you can't separate them chemically, so you have to separate them physically. And, oh by the way, that's super difficult. Which brings us to our topic of discussion for today. What if you could eliminate a lot of the bad things about uranium enrichment? What if you didn't have to physically separate something, but you could still get a kick-ass fissile material? Sorry to burst your bubble, bud, but nothing like that exists.
Yeah, bro, but like, what if you could make something like that exist?
Well, you know, that's actually not a bad idea. Remember when we were talking about Chicago Pile 1 and I said how Fermi had to slow the neutrons down? Yeah, the reason is because U-238 likes to capture a neutron of any speed between wicked fast or wicked slow. That's wicked bad for fission, but some people theorized it might have some interesting other consequences. When U-238 captures a neutron, it becomes uranium-239. The vagaries of nuclear binding energy being what they are, I am not going back there! Uranium-239 is unstable because of a wonky proton-neutron ratio. It was theorized that it would experience beta minus decay, which comes with an electron and an electron neutrino. Don't worry about it. The interesting part here is it would also convert a neutron into a proton, thus giving us the same number of nucleons. However, we increase the number of protons going from uranium to a previously never before seen element 93. First proven by Edwin McMillan, Nobel Prize of Physics in 1951. And wouldn't you know it, Philip Abelson, maker of HEX, pioneer of thermal diffusion uranium enrichment, international man of mystery, and also eventually the editor of Science for 22 years. In 1940, element 93 was named Neptunium and was the first transuranic element synthesized. But the fun doesn't stop there. It was theorized uranium-239 would be unstable, and it was theorized neptunium-239 would also be unstable. It was theorized it could go through beta minus decay again, another electron neutrino, but it would turn another neutron into another proton and become element 94! Oh, I'm so excited I can't sit still! Enrico Fermi, remember him, thought he'd synthesized magic element 94 in the late 1930s. But he didn't. Can't win them all, pal. Even still, a number of prominent scientists came to the same threefold conclusion. Number one, if U-238 captures a neutron, it becomes U-239 and should theoretically beta decay twice into element 94-239. And if you'll notice how many neutrons 94-239 has, it could be an excellent fission candidate by the added nuclear binding bonus that you get with the odd number of neutrons becoming an even number of neutrons. And if you could get magical fissile element 94-239, you'd be able to chemically separate it from the parent uranium, which is like a million times easier than separating U-235 from U-238. Basically, that means it's a quicker, easier way to an atomic bomb! Now, we just had to synthesize the material, determine all of its properties, manufacture it at a massive scale, separate and purify it to weapons-grade levels, melt-cast it into usable billets, and put it in an atomic bomb. Simple, right? Hey, where are you going? In late 1940, Edwin McMillan, discoverer of Neptunium, left Cal Berkeley to work on radar research for the war effort, offering to selflessly continue his research of discovering new elements to international fame and acclaim was chemist Glenn Seaborg. In order to find element 94, two experiments were proposed. One would smack uranium with deuterons, that is, the nucleus of a deuterium atom, a single proton, and neutron. The other would smack uranium with just a single old neutron. While I'll be frequently summarizing his group by just saying Seaborg, it was a team of people that worked day and night to make all of these discoveries happen. So please don't think that I'm misconstruing this by saying Seaborg by himself was working and making all these discoveries. At the same time, Seaborg overworked himself to being forced to go on vacation partway through World War II. The deuteron experiment involved the U-238 picking up the deuteron and then spitting out two neutrons. What would also be created is neptunium-238. The idea with that is the Neptunium-238 would beta decay into magical element 94-238, and that would be a very powerful alpha emitter. So it would spit out alpha particles, that is helium nuclei, that is 2 protons, 2 neutrons, for a total of 4. Really what they were looking for in the deuteron experiment was the presence of the alpha particles to back into the presence of that element 94-238 isotope. The neutron experiment is similar to before. The hope is the uranium would just capture it and then beta decay into Neptunium-239. The Neptunium-239 would then do the same thing as the Neptunium-238, just with an extra neutron. This approach was headed up by Emilio Segre. On 20 January 1941, Seaborg's team saw radiation unique from uranium and neptunium. This was almost certainly element 94, but they had to separate it from every other element to make sure. After all, people had been discovering new elements for the last 20 years. They were able to separate it from almost everything, but it took the crazy oxidizing agent persulfate, either SO5-2- or S2O8-2- to separate it from pesky thorium. Keep in mind that Seaborg's experiments here were done at what was called the ultra-micro scale. I'm not sure why they didn't just call it the nanoscale, but I digress. Rhodes analogizes this process to weighing invisible samples on invisible balances. I did some mini-scale work in organic lab in college, and it sucks. Every little piece of your product that goes away in a 5-milliliter flask, a little pipette, or an eensy-weensy piece of whey paper is a significant portion of your synthetic yield. Imagine accidentally sneezing and losing half of the world's supply of the most valuable material known to man. It's sort of like that scene in Annie Hall where Woody Allen sneezes all the cocaine away, except way more valuable than nose candy. Anywho, when it was finally separated from thorium, Seaborg's material was definitively identified as element 94. While it wasn't officially named until a year later, in keeping with the theme of uranium and neptunium, Seaborg's element 94 was named plutonium. Seaborg thought that sounded better than plutium. Also, basically as a joke, Seaborg made the atomic symbol for plutonium PU as a nod to the thing you say when you smell something stinky. Yes, that's a true story. Also as a funny side note, during its development, plutonium was coated copper in some experiments to keep its secrecy. This unfortunately became a little clunky when actual copper was used in other experiments, so they reverted back to calling plutonium its given name. Rest assured, we're always going to call it plutonium here because this stuff is complicated enough as it is. The initial synthesis of plutonium is awesome and stuff, but if it was nuclear dirt, it really didn't mean much aside from whoop-de-doo, a new element. If plutonium fissioned like uranium, though, now we've got something that could affect the outcome of the war. Seaborg took about 3 pounds of uranyl nitrate and continually smacked it with neutrons in the Berkeley 60-inch cyclotron. 2 days later, they hopefully had a decent amount of Neptunium-239, plus a bunch of other junk they needed to get rid of. They started extracting, first in diethyl ether, and then they co-precipitated the neptunium with lanthanum-3-fluoride and cerium-3-fluoride. 6 straight times. This process also involves sulfuric acid, hydrofluoric acid, sodium bromate, and, innocently, plain old water. At any rate, they'd finally purified the Neptunium-239 from all the other junk, and they deposited it on a platinum dish to leave it sit for a few days to beta decay into Plutonium-239. On 28 March 1941, the team first demonstrated that Plutonium-239 would fission. With a larger sample in May, they showed that plutonium-239's cross-section for fission was larger than that for U-235's. What that meant is the plutonium bomb would be smaller, which was awesome because, you know, the bomb would actually have to be transported by something from A to B. With this, we had all the groundwork for the plutonium project. We knew we could make plutonium by irradiating U-238 with neutrons. It would capture a neutron and double beta decay into plutonium-239. We also knew Pu-239 fissioned better than uranium. Now the trouble was making enough plutonium for a bomb and separating it from all the other junk in the parent uranium. And to paraphrase Jeff Goldblum in Jurassic Park, that is one big pile of trouble. While both these problems were tackled simultaneously by different pieces of the Met Lab in Chicago, we're going to break them up for simplicity and talk about the reactors first. For a plutonium nuclear reactor, the big three considerations are fuel, moderator, and coolant. After those three are decided, it's basically just an engineering question on how big you want it to determine how much plutonium is needed to win the war. Because uranium was the only fuel out there that could make plutonium, the fuel question was an easy one to answer. On the moderator side, most people loved Super Pure Graphite, not only because it was available, but also because it was proven in Chicago Pile 1. That being said, in the Manhattan Project spirit of using all sorts of options simultaneously, heavy water, D2O, was also considered. With only a single proton and single neutron, the deuterium atoms in D2O did a really good job at slowing down those neutrons. For that reason, there was a small heavy water cottage industry, and a handful of plants were established in Trail, British Columbia, Montgomery, Alabama, Dana, Indiana, and Morgantown, West Virginia. The coolant, the third part in our process, caused quite a stir. The reactor would produce a boatload of energy, and without an effective way to dissipate that energy, the reactor would have a meltdown. Literally. Think Three Mile Island, Fukushima, or Chernobyl. Some folks recommended helium gas, some folks recommended liquid bismuth, and some even recommended water or heavy water. Per usual,
is that Enrico Fermi's music?
After Chicago Pile 1 laid the groundwork for the reactors to follow, it was disassembled and its pieces used to make Chicago Pile 2 at the now-built Argon Lab outside Chicago. Fermi spearheaded improvements in reactor design that, when coupled with similar improvements to the graphite and uranium in the pile, allowed CP2 to be air or water cooled instead of cooled by the less neutron scavenging but also harder to work with helium. Even before Chicago Pile 1 went critical, it was decided there would be a pilot reactor to work out all the kinks for the larger production reactors. With Oak Ridge coming online anyway, a small section of that facility was devoted to a pilot or semi-works plutonium reactor. How the reactor got to Oak Ridge is the result of some stick swinging, except not with sticks. Basically, Arthur Compton and the Met Lab wanted the reactor in Chicago, and DuPont, the building contractor, wanted it in Tennessee. DuPont ended up winning, but then they asked the Met Lab to operate the reactor for him. The response was basically, to hell with you. After additional weeks of stick measuring, Compton decided to accept the contract out of little more than patriotic duty. It was a dangerous assignment 500 miles from home, but it was war. At any rate, the pilot reactor became known as X-10 and was an air-cooled system that was a training ground for the production reactors yet to be built. X-10 also provided the Manhattan Project its first samples of usable plutonium, and that greatly influenced the implosion bomb design at Los Alamos. Also, X-10 had holes drilled in it for experiments, such as irradiating small animals and seeing what would happen.
Never saw that in the owner's manual.
On the production side of things, it was decided in December 1942 that Hanford, Washington would be the site of the production reactors and separation facilities. Hanford was chosen for three big reasons. Number one, it was far enough away from the coast as to be defended from air bombings. Number two, it had ample water supply from the Columbia River in order to cool the reactors. And number three, it was far enough away from civilization to be kept secret, but also close enough to civilization to support manpower. The production facilities and separation plants began construction in October of 1943. This is a very small representation of a Hanford reactor. It's basically a giant block of graphite with a bunch of cylindrical holes drilled through it. The uranium slugs would be inserted into the holes and then blasted with neutrons to transmutate the uranium into that valuable plutonium. The slugs would leave just enough space in the cylinder so the cooling water could flow through it continuously and pull all the energy created by the reactor. I'm only showing this as five holes here, but in reality, the Hanford reactors were gigantic and had well over 1,000 holes. You can still visit the B reactor. It's about 3.5 hours southeast of Seattle. Once the reaction was complete, the irradiated slugs would be pushed through the reactor and plop out the back into a 20-foot deep pool of water. This allowed the reactor to be run remotely to protect everybody from the radiation. Even still, there was a giant concrete block put in front of the reactor, and the new slugs were used as the pushing rods to push the old slugs out the back. The irradiated slugs were collected and moved 5 miles away from the reactors to await their radioactivity to decrease. After that, they were moved to the separation facilities. The separation buildings were nicknamed the Queen Marys because they resembled an ocean liner. 800 feet long, each of the Queen Marys had 7-foot thick concrete walls and 6-foot thick concrete lids. They needed to be that thick to protect people from the insane amounts of radiation that would come out of the slugs when they exited the production piles. Hanford would need insane amounts of material of all types, extremely tight tolerances on every piece of every reactor and separator, and tens of thousands of workers from somewhere. Much like the thorn in the elephant's foot, however, the sealing of the lowly uranium slugs was the single most critical task at Hanford and could bring the whole thing crashing down. To prevent corrosion of the uranium from the cooling water in the piles, the slugs had to be sealed. Any water touching the pure uranium would hurt plutonium production and harm the reactor itself. Early production of this was done with giant vats of stuff that people would hand dip the slugs into every single step of the way. This process was painfully manual and led to many more rejects than acceptable slugs. Unlike the struggles at Y-12 and K-25 at Oak Ridge, the canning crisis at Hanford was luckily solved before the reactor went online. In August of 1944, here's what the final canning sealing process looked like. Step 1. The pure uranium slugs were degreased in trichloroethene and then pickled in nitric acid and rinsed a couple times. Step 2. The slugs would be dipped in hot bronze between 660 and 770 degrees C. Incidentally, the bronze used here had a very high ratio of tin, where normal bronze is about 12% or so. After the bronze, the slug would be dipped in pure tin below 660 C. After being centrifuged, the slug would be dipped into an aluminum-silicon alloy bath into which an aluminum can had already been submerged. The can, by the way, was cleaned in sodium dichromate and rinsed in methanol before it went into the bath. Everything is submerged here and the slug is slammed into the aluminum can, and then an aluminum lid was mashed on top of that. Finally, the sealed can would be quenched in water to prevent any of the aluminum from melting off. And that is how to make an aluminum slug for a plutonium reactor 101. The cans were then tested for seal by freezing them in ace naphthalene and carbon tet, sweet, steaming them in an autoclave, and x-raying them for voids / porosity. Barring a failure in any one of those tests, a slug was ready for the reactor. After a humongous effort in this hazardous and laborious process, enough good slugs were ready for a full plutonium run. With everything built and ready to go, B pile went critical just after midnight on September 27, 1944, and died less than 24 hours later, even though every single control rod was completely removed. The pile returned to critical the next day. 12 hours after that, it died again. Princeton theoretical physicist John Wheeler deduced the problem. Iodine-135 is made as a byproduct of uranium fission. Iodine-127 is the most stable form of iodine, and as it turns out, is the only stable form of iodine. So you can see 135 has 8 too many neutrons. That's a good candidate to make it pretty darn tootin' unstable. Unstable equals radioactive. And in this instance, 5 hours after it's created, iodine-135 beta decays into xenon-135. And xenon-135 likes neutrons like my doggo likes tennis balls. Xenon-135 is the strongest known neutron absorber and is dubbed a neutron poison because it has a tendency to royally mess up a critical nuclear reactor. To recap, uranium slugs are irradiated with neutrons to create plutonium-239. Iodine-135, however, is created as a byproduct. In 5 hours or so, it decays into xenon-135, which kills the reactor. About 9 hours after that, the xenon has decayed enough through its own half-life that the reactor comes back online. This whole thing repeats until you get more iodine, more xenon, your reactor dies again, da-da-da-da-da-da. Without going into exact numbers, you can throttle the power of your reactor to account for the neutron poison. As the xenon comes and goes, you can move the reactor power up and down and continue making plutonium. With the reactor's problems figured out, Seaborg's chemists could get to work on separating the freshly made plutonium out of the uranium slugs. From the ultra-micro scale at the University of Chicago to the full-scale production separations at Hanford, Seaborg claimed that this process was the largest scale-up in the history of chemistry. The production process was thusly developed. I almost loathe talking about this because it is just a miserable, miserable series of reaction conditions that create a truly horrible, nasty, radioactive, corrosive, toxic sludge of waste products and also some wicked fissile plutonium. But this is hardcore chemistry, and why the heck else are you here? So let's get after it. In the irradiated uranium fuel slug, the concentration of plutonium was, if the scientists were lucky, about 250 parts per million. So you couldn't just precipitate it out of solution. First, you had to concentrate it. But also not concentrate it too much, lest you create a critical mass and blow up part of Washington State. To concentrate the plutonium, what's called a carrier was used. In theory, the carrier is added to the plutonium and other junk solution, and the plutonium sticks to the carrier. Then the uranium and other fission products could be washed away, leaving the concentrated plutonium and the carrier. At that point, you could theoretically wash the carrier away and be left with good pure plutonium. Initially, Seaborg's team investigated four separation techniques. The first, the one Seaborg himself worked on, was using lanthanum-3 fluoride to grab the plutonium out of solution as we've just described it. The second separation technique was peroxide separation. For some reason, though, plutonium did not want to play ball and would not form soluble peroxide products. Eventually, the chemist found out if they added hydrogen peroxide to a solution of uranyl nitrate, they could get it to precipitate out. But the rest of the precipitate was tremendous. For that reason, lanthanum fluoride still won. Third was a silicate process. While silicates did absorb more plutonium than other substrates, it still wasn't very efficient. So, lanthanum fluoride again. Finally was solvent extraction, but that was so bad we don't even want to talk about it. A crucial discovery in this time frame was that plutonium had two main oxidation states, +4 and +6. That really wasn't the crucial part. The crucial part was that each oxidation state had particular elements that it liked to hang out with. So you could selectively oxidize and reduce the plutonium back and forth between its oxidation states to increasingly separate it from other elements and purify it. The lanthanum fluoride process was thus approved for both Oak Ridge and Hanford. Unfortunately, as the process became more mature, a few difficulties emerged. First, gobs of HF were required, and we already know how bad that is. Second, hexavalent plutonium. Let me pause here and say if the phrase hexavalent plutonium doesn't make your skin crawl, recalibrate. Was a big pain to stabilize. Because of these troubles, Seaborg then asked Stanley Thompson to investigate phosphate separations, PO4-3-. Thompson unsuccessfully tried zirconium, uranium, niobium, thorium, and cerium phosphates. How he had any of these materials on hand is beyond me, but I digress. Then, even though he didn't think it would work, and there was no good chemical reason why it would, Thompson tried bismuth phosphate, and found it carried 98% of the plutonium. Science, am I right? Throughout this whole process, stuff is going to go into and come out of solution pretty regularly. Because the first step deals with a boiling aqueous solution, I'm going to denote everything throughout as aqueous, AQ, just to keep it simple. If you want to debate the semantics between using the AQ notation or the SLN notation, feel free to send me an email. Hey, you remember the aluminum can? You know, the thing that took insane amounts of effort to make sure it was totally sealed so it wouldn't mess up anything in the reactor? Yeah, the first step in the bismuth phosphate process was just get rid of that whole thing. The aluminum was dissolved in boiling sodium hydroxide to create sodium aluminate. Those of you adept chemists out there will notice that there's hydrogen gas produced as a byproduct. Think Hindenburg. To prevent that whole thing from happening, sodium nitrate is added, reacts with the hydrogen gas, and creates ammonia, sodium hydroxide comes back here, and two harmless waters. The second step in the process was to dissolve the solid metal slugs. To do this, enough nitric acid was added to dissolve 1 ton of metal at a time and put it into solution. I like to work with larger amounts of material when I can, but the most nitric acid I've ever worked with at one time is 20 liters. This is a whole different level! Next, bismuth-3 nitrate and phosphoric acid were added to the slug solution. This created bismuth phosphate in situ, which precipitated out after grabbing all the nice plutonium. Everything else stayed in solution. This whole thing was centrifuged, giving us a really nice bismuth phosphate / plutonium precipitate cake. Real quick, the plutonium right now is in an oxidation state of +4. In step 4, the precipitate is added to nitric acid to dissolve the plutonium, and either sodium bismuthate or potassium permanganate is added to oxidize the plutonium from +4 to +6. Sodium dichromate is also added to lock the plutonium into that +6 oxidation state. What we've done in the last two steps is first separated the plutonium from almost all the other junk by co-precipitating with bismuth phosphate. In this step, we've separated the plutonium from the bismuth phosphate. Step 5 sees the plutonium in solution reduced by ammonium iron 2 sulfate down to the +4 oxidation state. Then basically steps 3 and step 4 happen all over again. The plutonium is re-co-precipitated with bismuth phosphate, re-oxidized back to the +6 to separate it from the bismuth phosphate in an additional couple steps of purification. Then the plutonium is re-reduced back to +4 and sent to a different building. Step 6 sees an additional purification. The Pu plus 4 is oxidized to Pu plus 6, and phosphoric acid only is added to wash away more impurities. As far as I can tell, we still have plutonium in the plus 6 state in solution, it's just more pure than it was when it started this step. Next, generic lanthanum salts, the anion doesn't matter so I'm just denoting it by X, and hydrofluoric acid are added to create lanthanum 3 fluoride. This precipitates out of solution and carries all other junk metals like cerium, strontium, basically anything that the bismuth phosphate wouldn't separate with the plutonium is grabbed by the lanthanum 3 fluoride. Our plutonium 6 plus is still in solution, but man, it's looking better and better every single step. The plutonium is then reduced to the plus 4 oxidation state by oxalic acid, and the lanthanum fluoride process is repeated. However, this time, because the plutonium is in its plus 4 oxidation state, when the lanthanum 3 fluoride precipitates from solution, the plutonium comes with it. In our penultimate step, the lanthanum 3 fluoride plutonium combo is reacted with sodium hydroxide to make plutonium lanthanum oxide. I have no idea what the molecular formula of that is, and I didn't want to make something up, so you get generic subscripts. At any rate, that stuff is reacted with nitric acid, and you end up with plutonium 4 nitrate. I kind of pulled a fast one on you there, and I gotta apologize. Back when the plutonium went to the second building a few steps ago, it started getting concentrated. In the last few steps, 330 gallons of plutonium solution have now gone to 8 gallons of plutonium solution. Step 10, our final step.
They grow up so fast!
The plutonium nitrate solution had peroxides added to it, just in case there was any plutonium 6 hanging around in there, it would react and precipitate out as plutonium 6 peroxide. Then nitric acid was added to that to bring it back into solution, presumably in plutonium 6 nitrate. Then the whole shebang was boiled into a nice thick plutonium nitrate paste. This paste was then shipped to Los Alamos, fulfilling the primary mission of the Hanford facility. Synthesize plutonium from uranium and separate it to a sufficient degree of purity. In summary, the Hanford separation process used two different oxidation states of plutonium and selective co-precipitations with bismuth phosphate and lanthanum 3 fluoride to purify plutonium to the degree necessary for the Manhattan Project. Before we get out of here on this one, I gotta do a grab bag on some of these nuggets that didn't really fit anywhere else but I couldn't not talk about. Glenn Seaborg, and of course his group, was responsible for so many discoveries in the actinide series that he was responsible for the periodic table having to be redrawn. Get this, americium, curium, berkelium, californium, einsteinium, fermium, mendelevium, nobelium, and seaborgium, which was named for Seaborg. Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1951. Badass. Seaborg's approach to recruiting was not exactly forthcoming. It went something like this. I can't tell you what you'll be doing, but it's more important than the discovery of electricity. Just come to Chicago and I'll tell you all about it. Surprisingly, that usually did the trick. Seaborg also got a kick out of asking his students what they thought they'd be doing when they came to work for him. A couple even said, "Well, I don't know, Glenn, but I do know it'll have to do with one of the 92 known elements." And one quick one about Hanford. At its peak, water consumption in the production reactors rivaled that of a 1 million person city. Wow. By December 1944, B pile and D pile were producing plutonium in quantity, and the bismuth phosphate process was separating and purifying it by the pound. James Conant wrote on 6 January 1945, quote, "Looks like a race to see whether a fat man or a thin man will be dropped first, and whether the month will be either July, August, or September," end quote. How right he was. But that's for then, and this is for now. See you next time. You know, we're sitting on 4 million pounds of fuel, one nuclear weapon, and a thing that has 270,000 moving parts built by the lowest bidder. Makes you feel good, doesn't it?